Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Today I want to talk about how we talk about technology and specifically how we compare how mature different technologies are. It's actually one thing that really annoys me about the way that energy technology is covered in the media. Scientific or technical advance is reported and we're told all about the problems with existing alternative technologies and told all about the potential of the new technology. But it's not common that we hear about how much risk there is, that the new one won't work as expected, or how long it might take until it becomes available to use. In today's video, I'm going to explain the framework that we use to discuss these sorts of issues, which is called a Technology Readiness Level framework. I'm going to explain the origin of the scale, how it's used, and then give some examples of green energy technologies and how they fit into it. I feel like I am frequently bombarded with news of brand new energy technologies that claim to be the solution to all of the challenges of the green energy transition. And if this new and perfect solution is coming up, then why would we bother persevering with today's non-perfect solutions? That's why I want to talk today a bit about technology readiness levels. I think that when we don't specifically focus on technology maturity, it can cause people to feel less positive towards current technologies and divert resources away from their implementation. And this is important because we don't have time to wait for the future's perfect technologies. We need action on climate change now. So what we need is a shared understanding of technology maturity and risk. And in fact, such a framework does exist, but I haven't heard it discussed outside of the pretty limited groups of those intimately involved in technology development projects, engineers like myself. So in this video, I want to introduce the concept to a wider audience in the hope that we can start to develop more realistic expectations about new technologies as they are reported. One reason why this is a tricky thing to discuss is that this concept of a mature technology is kind of rubbery. A technology that one person calls mature, another person might see a lot of development work still needs to be done. And this kind of mismatch, it's not just limited to conversations between technology experts and the general public. It's also a very common cause of problems within teams working on new technology development projects, especially when it comes time to hand over a project from one group to another. So, for example, when a new technology goes from a research and development team to the sales team, how do you know when it's ready, and how will you know if you're likely to experience problems with the integration of this new technology into an existing product? This is a challenge that I know way too well. I've faced it in probably every single job that I've had in my career, and it was also apparently a problem for NASA back in the 1970s. I think it's always nice to feel like you have something in common with a NASA engineer. So back in the 70s, some clever people at NASA were concerned with the differing perceptions of the researchers and the mission planners between the intended and the actual proof of readiness. And so they came up with the idea of technology readiness levels to bridge across these differences. Originally, it was a 7-point scale where 1 was basically like an idea someone had in the shower and 7 was a totally finished technology that had been to space. Now TRL has spread way beyond just NASA into other industries like defense and infrastructure and my own industry, renewable energy technologies. Companies use it for a bunch of things, for example, to guide technology development projects and to make sure that the technologies are developed enough before they go to market. They also use it to categorize their research and development project portfolios so they can make sure that they've got a good stream of new technologies that are gonna, you know, come to maturity over the coming years. And governments can also use it, for example, in technology roadmaps like this Australian one, or as a criterion for eligibility to grants or procurement programs. So you might say that this program's open to TRL 7 and above. This is an attempt to make sure that they're not buying like an idea in the shower kind of technology when they really meant to buy something that would be commercially ready next year. So these days, the scale that's used most commonly is a 9-point scale, and I'm just going to run through it really quickly. TRL 1 is still just an idea, and TRL 2 is thinking of a potential application for that idea. TRL 3 provides some proof of feasibility of the critical function. That could be either some analysis or a lab scale proof of concept. Many of the new exciting energy technologies that get reported in the media are in this range of TRL 1 to 3. Examples include nuclear fusion and space-based solar power. And some of these technologies, like nuclear fusion, have been at TRL 3 for decades. It's a very common technology joke that nuclear fusion is always 30 years away. And this highlights the fact that these early level technologies just may never progress to maturity, even if it's a great idea with potential. So next we get to TRL 4, which is component testing or some basic integration of functions in a lab environment. And then TRL 5, where components or maybe a small scale or simplified prototype is tested in a more realistic environment. So it's at this point that we've gone from an idea that might have a practical application to an actual technology. This is the point that I'm normally starting to work with a technology, although I do think it is fun to start a lot earlier. And by this point of TRL 5, you pretty much know that with enough time and enough budget, you could get it to work. But there's no guarantee of how long that might take or whether the end product will be cheap or reliable enough to make it commercially viable. It might sound like TRL 5 with a prototype tested in a realistic environment is pretty much mature technology. But any engineer like me who works on technologies at this stage can tell you that there are still so many things that can go wrong and do go wrong pretty much every single time. Examples of TRL 4 to 5 energy technologies include electrical hydrogen aircraft, electrified steel manufacturing, and small modular nuclear. So after this point, we are starting to get to technologies that are in a form that more closely resembles to what you will see when they're fully commercialized. The next few levels are about more realistic testing and more performance data. So TRL 6 is a functional prototype in a representative environment. So an example of a TRL 6 technology is this energy storage prototype that I recently visited in Ticino, Switzerland. TRL 7 is a demonstration of a prototype in the actual environment. So for the example of, say, wave energy technology, this might mean the difference between testing a small prototype in a wave pool versus testing it in the actual ocean. And TRL 8 is more rigorous testing of a prototype in its actual environment. Smart charging, ultra high voltage transmission, and carbon capture and storage of direct industrial emissions fit in here. TRL 9 is a commercially mature technology with verified performance data. So here we find technologies like battery electric vehicles, heat pumps, wind and solar, pumped hydro, technologies that we have seen used for years in a variety of circumstances, so they've demonstrated their reliability. So after that, there can actually be extensions to the scale. Some systems use like a 9+ to distinguish between recently commercialized early adoption technologies and ones that have a long history of use. Some other systems prefer to swap to a commercial readiness level after TRL 9 to describe pretty much the same thing. So, what did you think about where I placed different technologies within the scale? Did you agree with every single one, or maybe did you disagree on some? I would actually be surprised if you didn't disagree on something, because even though the TRL scale tries really hard to be an objective measure, there is inevitably judgment involved. There's a lot of different versions of the TRL scale used by different organizations, and though they're mostly roughly consistent, there are some differences, and then there's always debate within groups about where a technology fits from one level to the next. In a later video, I'm going to delve more into some of the limitations and weaknesses of the TRL system, and especially I want to talk a lot about some common ways that technology maturity is misused or talked about in a maybe misleading way when it comes to renewable energy technologies. So make sure to subscribe and turn on notifications to make sure that you see when that video comes out.
So thank you for watching today, and I hope that you learned something about technology maturity and how to talk about that. And as always, if there's a topic you want to discuss more, then please let me know in the comments. And don't forget to like the video and share with your friends if you want to see more content like this.
And I'll see you next time.